I'm going to try to keep it short and interactive. I have no slides, no stuff. Mahesh has kind of sort of talked about a few things that he'd like you to talk about. I try to cover this. And I'm very, very open to any and all Q&As at any point in time. Yeah. So he's asked me to talk about a couple of things, you know, a little about my story. And I try to keep that to as little as possible. What I've learned, and I'll try to spend a little more time on that, about business and entrepreneurship and what works and what doesn't. And strangely, he wanted me to talk about travel, which is nothing to do with either, and I kind of spend a little time on it. So, basically, I come from a pretty orthodox, Tamilian, Brahmin, Ayyar family. So, if you think you guys have a tough upbringing, that's one of the toughest upbringings, right? So, I was just telling Mahesh on the way out, you know, I remember in class 7 or class 8, I came home really happy with 9700 in maths. My dad was an army guy. And he took out his belt and gave me 3 for the 3 marks that I missed. So that's the kind of family you grew up in. Now, of course, the only career routes that are available to at that time were like doctor and engineer. Actually, it's a little more complicated. It's like if you do maths and science, you have a choice, engineer or doctor. If you go to maths but not science, you go to commerce. If you go to science but not maths, you become a doctor. If you're not good at maths and not good at science, you have to find somebody rich to marry. That's the options that is appropriate. Somehow blessed with some ability in maths and science, I was offered a choice and then I picked engineering because I couldn't stand the sight of a lot of people. Within the year, I kind of discovered that I had no interest in engineering either. So I just stopped going to college. At this point, my dad just looked down and said, "Hello, you. Why are you going to college?" He said, "I don't like college." So, you know, he just brought matters very quickly to a halt. Your army style is a different year. You are living in half four walls, and half four walls are my rules are that. And my rules are that as long as you live in my four walls, you will go to college. Very simple way of stating the facts. So that day I left home and kind of sort of never went back. So I was 17, I was on the streets actually, and it was a little tough. I had some scholarship money. I managed to find some hotel room for 50 rupees a night. I found a job in the next salesman. I figured I was a really bad local salesman. I have a huge amount of respect. I did that for a year and a half, 2 years, and that's almost my MBA. It taught me a lot of things. I mean, I had to go knock on 25 doors a day, and 21 of those 25 times they didn't open the doors. And the other 4 out of the 5 times, they didn't buy anything. Right? So the first lesson that taught me was actually that after that, I could take any amount of romantic rejection. It's a consequence. Just you have to knock another door. No big deal if you know you're rejected yet again. Anyway, I moved from there. I tried to start a few companies. I failed. I figured I knew nothing about starting companies. So I did the next best thing. All of us were good at nothing. Good for nothing. We landed up in advertising. So I landed up in advertising. People were really good at nothing else. I ended up in advertising. As I'm sure you can also, many of your advertisers are all agencies and also good for nothing people. Launch MTV in India, I remember the quick and loaded stuff and all that. So I'm somewhat responsible for the decline of Indian culture in Australia. 20, 30 years. Then I was hired by an American agency, Silicon Valley agency. I did some interesting stuff, I had designed and launched Yahoo, and designed and launched Amazon. Invested in both my clients actually. And then my own company went public. Usually, went to a startup. And I got bored of the Silicon Valley scene about 15, 16 years ago. I got a strange offer to turn around a television channel in India. So I came back to India as a CEO of Channel B. My job was to sell the company. 2 years we sold it to Starry. So we sold it to Peter Murthy, just so. Very high for the last 15, 16 years that I've been in India, I've been doing a couple of things. I've been investing in startups. I've done my own personal fund called Passion Fund. I'm still the best person in three companies. And in about 2005, 2006, I teamed up with another Thai charter member from Bombay. One of the other things I did which really made a big impact on my life was I was part of Thais from 1999 in the US itself, and then formed Thai. Part of originally 2000 in Bombay. On the board for 8-9 years and been president. 2. And I teamed up with another TiE charity, Praveen Gandhi, and we launched a fund called Seed Fund about 10 years ago. Early stage fund, we've done reasonably well. I've invested in companies including Redbus, Carvalho, Chumbak, my dentist. So a few companies. And so that's the boring life story part of the university. I want to tell you about the stuff that I've learned that you might find interesting. I'm going to try to keep it short because I do know that there's a wide variety of civil norms of reading the news. So a couple of things are rising, and you know, everything is neck and neck. And you can see that even today, for example, in the fossil fuel car industry, Volkswagen is world number one at 20.6% market share. Toyota is world number two at 20.2% market share. And General Motors is world number three at 19.8% market share. So on so forth. You know, the pharmaceutical companies are all bunched together very closely. But over the last 5 years, 5, 7, 8 years, I've seen something really different and really interesting happen. In category after category. So that Calvin Klein has $2 billion in sales. If I take instead of the soft drink industry, where Coke and Pepsi are making it, I come from the energy drink industry, which has really grown in the last 5, 7 years. Red Bull has a 46% market share globally. And Coke and Pepsi together have 11% market share. Something interesting happening there. And instead of the car industry, where we saw Toyota and Volkswagen so close to each other, the fossil fuel car industry. If I take the luxury electric car industry, Tesla has a 99% market share, and BMW I has 0.5% market share. Which is rising, you would expect the companies to be really close by together. But something interesting is happening. So all of you are on WhatsApp. Now WhatsApp has 72% global market share, and WeChat has 18%. When you use Google, when you search, you use Google, Google has 93% global market share. I bet you can't name one or two. In terms of online video, YouTube has 85% market share. I bet you can't win number 2 or number 3 globally.
That's not daily
money. But here's the interesting thing. If I take the pharmaceutical industry in India, even a number 10 guy in India is probably worth 500 crores. The founder is probably worth 500 crores. But here, you take an industry like video, you don't even know who the number 3 is globally. It's not even known. Imagine that. Industry after industry, you will see that. In its own niche, Santa Monica has 8% market share. Okay? And the government. If you look at any niche, for example, if you look at marketplaces, if you a mall, the terrestrial equivalent is malls. So the largest mall is the mall in Minneapolis or whatever it is. That probably has 0.2 market share of all the malls in the US. So if you look at malls outside China, you will know the world is 80% market share. So the really interesting thing that I've seen happen is in the world that I grew up in, I used to see that the number one company would fight to get 15, 16, 18, 20% market share. Number two would get 16% market share. Number three would get 14% market share. Number four would get 12% market share. Fight to the win. The really interesting thing that's happening is that in almost every industry, number one gets 85% market share. Number gets 8.5% market share. Number three gets 0.85% market share. Industry after industry after industry. It's almost like earlier even this linear thing now is this power of 10 dollar. That's really interesting. Especially because I'm an investor and I want to, obviously, it makes it harder and easier because I have the only real chance I have is if I invest in something that becomes a number one. I have a small chance it becomes a number one. Number three, I have more chance. So this is really interesting. So I looked into seeing, okay, what is it that I can do? And we ended up, in some ways, when we sold Redbus to had 88% market share. We sold Carvalho at almost 90% market share. Edward Chumbak in the suite has 80%+ market share. My dentist is the largest dental chain in India. It's more than 2.5 times larger than Apollo Hospital's dental chain. So some interesting things really came to light, isn't it? What creates these super dominant companies? The first thing is money, but actually that's not the case. almost every single one of these companies that we talked about did not receive a lot of money. I know how much we put in Redbus. I know how much we put in Carbon. WhatsApp received $10 million of funding. That's it. Before it was acquired for $21 billion. Somebody made a big, enormous gain on that one. So here's a really interesting thing. The first thing that we want to know. But each of these brands I mentioned, you know, is a big brand. You've all heard of Tesla, you've all heard of WhatsApp, you've all heard of Facebook, you've all heard of Google, you've all heard of Amazon, you've all heard of eBay, you've all heard of Redbus and Red Bull and Zara. The incredible similarity that we saw across all of these brands is that none of them ever advertised. When have you ever seen a Google ad? When have you seen an ad for WhatsApp? When have you ever seen an ad for Facebook? Zara has never advertised in this life. Neither does Tesla. Red Bull almost never advertises. So the really interesting thing is that the absolute leaders never advertise. Well, the guys who are smaller spend and advertise a lot. So you see BMW, I advertising a lot, but still not making a dent against Tesla. Right? You will see Monster Energy Drinks advertising a lot, but not making a dent against Red Bull. And you will see this in every case after case after case. This is very curious. I spent almost all of my life in advertising, spending a lot of my clients' money, and telling them they need to spend more to build their brand. And the amazing thing is today, that the world's most powerful, richest, most profitable brands are all built with zero advertising. So something there really blew me away. So I decided to dig deeper and say, okay, what creates this? And you've seen this in every case after case after case, whether it's India. The same thing in politics. During the Delhi elections, the BJP spent 100 crores and the AEP spent zero. But AEP ended up with 67 seats out of 70 after spending zero. Right? And you'll see this. So there's something interesting that's happened. So when I tried to understand this, because obviously that, imagine that is so attractive to me as an investor, that the winning company spends less money than the losing company. That you fund a company more, it loses. You fund a company less, it wins. Man, I love that, right? So there's something really interesting in the formula I wanted to understand, and I wanted to get right. The first thing was really understanding what caused these brands to grow. What caused these brands? And we can go into some detail. Why do ladies, and it's very simple, you go to a mall in Delhi, Ambience or something else, and you can do this experiment. Look at the women going into Zara versus the women going to any other shop. Of 5 women who go into Zara, 2 will come out with a shopping bag. Of 10 women who go to any other shop, only 1 will come out with a shopping bag. Right? So Zara has figured out how to get women to convert at 3 or 4 times the rate of any other shop. We can talk about that later and I'll tell you about that strategy. Right? Look at Red Bull. It has a gut, I mean the cost of a soft drink is the cost of a soft drink, it's water and some flavor. While a Coca-Cola charges 20 rupees for a 330 ml can, Red Bull charges 95 rupees for a 200 ml can of essentially the same stuff. And gets away with no endorsements, no testimonials, no Hrithik Roshan, no Sachin Tendulkar, no Aishwarya Rai Bachchan, nothing. Right? These are all super profit brands that make money hand over fist by charging a huge amount of money. I just finished the biography of Elon Musk upstairs, right? Tesla sold the first 25,000 cars at $100,000 each with zero advertising. And there's something truly incredible that's happening out there. So I decided, so one, I figured that, okay, you have this ability to charge premium amounts of money. Second, more importantly, each of these brands have spread. How do we hear of Google? How do we hear of Zara? How do we hear of any of these brands? You only hear about them by word of mouth. There's something that has been, it's not accidental, that has been deliberately engineered into these brands. Virgin Grade, with unprecedented 34%. By re-engineering the buyer, by understanding the woman's cycle, and saying, okay, if she's postponing the decision, I have to make her panic, make her buy right now. And that's been the secret of creating a $20 million in sales, these are advertising. And because you have to buy it right now, your price is sensitive. Energy drinks have been there for a long time. Glucose 8, Gatorade have been 20, 30, 40 years. So one Austrian guy goes to Thailand. You see the drink, the trucker's drink, which has a lot of caffeine and a lot of sugar. He buys it, right? So actually he's not with his brand. Red Bull is still the brand for Curry, is owned by the original guy, the Thai company. He buys a license to the brand for outside Thailand. He goes back and says, that's interesting. It's a deal that gives a lot of energy. Now, everybody's looking the same data, and the standard marketing manager has deduced, a drink with a lot of energy. My target is youth. What should I do? Energy in sports. Let's get sports stars and let's get some big endorsements. And that's what data does. Hence, that's why you see Virat Kohli getting data on the field. Because you need a lot of money to get, bring data to the field. Right? And same as the two sportsmen around the world. Big ads, big campaigns, big sports. This kind of the same data. And came to a different insight, human insight. And his insight was, actually, how many of you really play sports? Almost nobody. Maybe 1%. Actually, among the youth, what do they actually spend their energy doing? Where do they need energy? Only place the youth spend energy is on the dance floor. Right? They don't go to the sports. So he says, they will now go to the dance floor. So they went into the clubs and pubs. They put a lot of incentive into the price and push the bargain to say, when somebody comes, is tired, offer them a Red Bull or a vodka with Red Bull or a gin with Red Bull or whatever they have with Red Bull. And from there comes this entire thing that Red Bull used to take, so you can ask. I mean, sure enough, people who are tired and fat, but who drink it and say, shh, you can ask more. And that's how the entire legend the word of mouth. If you're tired, drink a Red Bull and dance more. We went to word of mouth. Just like the story of Zara went to word of mouth, women say, I have a bite now, baby. Or it's just going, I'm hiding now, they take other women and they bite now. Right? So in each of these cases, it was inside. Gmail was an insight exactly like that. While everybody thought that mail was about sorting and so on, they had simple insight and popular in 25 years, 15 years. The simple insight was that we don't like deleting mail. I don't know where the Hotmail is, you keep deleting the mail to keep another 25 years. Google said, can I just stop this? It allows a 1G limit. Right? And within 3 months, we had another world. Right? So, case after case after case has been around actually designing a product that gets word of mouth. But designing it based on understanding consumers and gaining an insight that nobody else has gained from that consumer. This, at least it's my version of understanding, this actually gave me some strength to say, okay, fine. I'm a really small VC fund. My first fund I was managing 65 crores, my second fund I managed 330 crores. And the guys imagine billions and billions of dollars. I'm a really small fund. This gives me the ability to work with my companies to say, how can you figure out products that can grow by word of mouth? And that growth has to come from consumer insight. And that consumer, so for me this is, and the consumer insight is when people engineer the product in a way that actually explores the market. So we did that in the case of Red Bus. These guys came to us, they were selling at that point 2 tickets a day. And when they sold the company a couple of years ago, they were doing 85,000 tickets a day. So that was the, and we never, till the day we bought them, we sold them, we never saw any Red Bus commercials, no Red Bus advertising. He simply, while everybody else was advertising and my trip was number 2 in buses, we were 11 times bigger than we were. We understood again, the insight behind bus tickets was very straightforward. It was just understanding that, so I don't know what bus systems here, but for example, these are the intercity buses. So if you, in Bombay, you want to go to Pune, the way you used to do is just go to the other bus stop and say, Pia, Pune, 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 so you jump into that and you go to Pune. You get out as near Kolhapur ka bus ka to Kolsur Airport. So you find a 3-star lodge or something, or whatever you got, 1-star, you see them take a bus next time. You had no visibility. So these guys said, people want that visibility. So they just figured on a route, saying we will give you, say we will take 2 cities, Chennai and Hyderabad, and you give complete visibility, including seats available, so you can get a literally a boarding pass to see them. Right? So these guys were really, really hard to sign up the bus operators. But to sign up the bus operators, they have to do something else. You have to make sure, for example, the next guy didn't come and take the bus operators and inventory. So we did something pretty interesting. We did an ERP for the bus operator. We run his entire business and we gave it to him free. So now his business ran on our system. Now he was not going to shut down the whole ERP for his company to give somebody else bus tickets. So what happens even today is even the riders who sell tickets under their name buy from the bus operator, which has been bought off our system, so we make money from that. So again, this was really understanding what was needed in engineering that in some ways from inside. We did the same with Carvalho. You know, we started as a used car listing site. We grew and then we started plateauing and then, you know, the CEO Mohit came and said, you know, make sure we need advertising money. So then we joked about the fund is the guy who gives you our projects. We have projects with a lot of advertising. So he said, you know, can we engineer something in the product that can create so much delight that people actually want it? So we went and figured out what was the big problem when it comes to used cars. The problem was always that, see, I don't care about issues in Chandigarh, but in Bombay the pressure is to buy a used car. If you want to buy a new car, the first thing you have to do is sell your old car because you don't have parts. Right? So you now kind of stuck that you can't really buy the new car to be sell your old car. Sell the old car, you don't really understand what's happening there. Because you just say, achha, theek hai, mechanic ko bola itna deta hai. And you have no idea, you trust whatever the guy says. And he would lowball and you kind of, so you never knew whether you were getting a good deal or not. So what these guys did was really interesting, because every car sale has to be registered. They plowed through RDO data for the last 2 years. Every single car transaction used in new. And they came up with a simple set of rules. They said, theek hai, if you're in 2010 and you're buying a 2005 Maruti Zen EX, which is Thane registered with 40,000 kilometers, this is the kind of price you should sell it. We simply created that used car price and it took 2.5 months to create that. From publicly available data, we put it up. Within the next 3 months, the traffic shot up 10 times. Because we became the de facto pricing agent. Anybody who should be a Karwala Ram price, main wo lagta hai. We became the absolute busy guy. So we figured out there was some consumer delight that we could simply offer by engineering the product differently. So we still do that today. Today, in a lot of ways, with every startup, I sit back and say, okay, fine, what is in your product that can really, really make this brand go viral through word of mouth? My own bias, I come from a consumer marketing and advertising background, is towards consumer brands driven more by tech in some ways. Okay? But the same is true even in B2B. In enterprise software, Salesforce won over the whole world without spending a dime on advertising. Amazon Cloud, one over the entire world without spending a dime on advertising. The same is true, not just in B2C, it's also true in B2B. We are all human beings at the end of it. And at the base of it is really this insight that if today Sharuk was to tell me which car to buy, he says, yeah, drive an i10 because I drive an i10. I have zero credit because Sharuk Khan doesn't drive an i10. But if my friend says, look, if you're buying an i10 or, you know, instead buy this Honda or whatever, if Munish tells me, I say, yeah, fine, because he's got, I trust him more than I trust Sharuk. So actually the nature of testimonials has changed. We really don't trust endorsements. Right? How many of you really believe Sharuk drives an i10? So we trust peers to give us reviews. So ditto, some reviewer from Times of India writes a review about a movie, it has no value. You go on Facebook and see what your friends say. They don't need you. And that's what creates your desire. So the entire thing is about creating a wave of good word of mouth. So a lot of what we do is look at product, figure out how can you create this wave of good word of mouth in the right target audience. Whether it is enterprise purchasing guys, whether it's a sales guy, whether it's a house buyer, whether it's a team. And the buttons are different in this case, as different as the Red Bull button was from the Zara button. For the WhatsApp button and so on and so forth. Yeah. And it's not never about over-engineering. If you remember to a couple of years ago, WhatsApp, all you could do was text. But WeChat came out with video text, we do video, we do audio, we do desktop to mobile, mobile to desktop, desktop to tablet, tablet to desktop, we do everything. And WhatsApp only did phone to phone. Text. But its insight was very clear. Its insight to the consumers was that consumers want to buy mobile messaging. So even today, if you see, when you switch on your phone and switch on here, the first thing that lights up is your WhatsApp messages. The first byte that goes, the first byte that goes is simply engineered that way. By doing that one little thing, by actually under-engineering the product compared to WeChat, the one on the market. Without spending one message. You've never seen WhatsApp. While WeChat has had Parinithi Chopra and Varun Dhawan to spend 100 crores in 3 months and come nowhere in India. And nowhere in the industry. I see this time and again, time and again, time and again. If you spend on advertising, you actually die fast. And the reason for that is not too complex. We live in a world where today the largest media in the world is internet. 4.5 billion people out of 7 billion people are online. Even in India today, there are only 110 million TV sets, according to our last census. Even if you allocate 2.5 people per household to watch TV, that's 260 million viewers. There are already 350 million viewers on YouTube. The largest mass media in India is online, is internet. Right. The second largest mass medium is a Bible center. The third largest mass medium is television. And then comes print and so on. Radios, and you've seen that. I've done quite some work helping the AAP. And what we figured, but when does a Rishawala have a cell phone? Strangely, he has a cell phone. It may not be a data enabled cell phone, but his kid has one. Somebody in the family, that youth, is there to tell the elders how to vote. Because they figure something, they read something on the internet that they don't even particularly trust mainstream media. So it's huge change that's happening out there. So this is a huge opportunity. The way I look at it, it's incredible. Because if you're an entrepreneur, it's cheaper than ever before and easier than ever before to create an incredibly dominant company. If you're an existing large-scale business, you should worry, because it's easier than ever before for somebody to disrupt you. So we can go into this. I mean, what does it need for you to change to become this person? Again, we try to look at it. First, you have to believe absolutely in it. You as the entrepreneur, you as the founder, you as the CEO. If you don't, and just there's somebody junior something, they throw you, it's not going to work. That's the first thing. The second thing is, what kind of people are you hiring? Many of us tend to hire people by human set of qualifications. We again looked into this and figured out, given the fact that the market is changing so fast, we have very little visibility in the future. But I don't know how companies give forecasts for the next 12 months. I personally don't know how my own companies are going to do in more than 6 months. I don't know. Even though I have fancy times information systems across my industry companies. Right? So what does it take? Because I don't have visibility. Right? And I don't know what the path is, and I can't draw a map and say go on the path. I mean, that was the way it used to be in the olden days. This is the path, go there. But now I don't know where it's going. I don't know who's going to come. So we need a different kind of person. A person, and the key skill that I look for in my companies, especially with the CSO level, is what I call comfort with ambiguity. As we are really comfortable with the fact that we're never going to have enough information. And you can take decisions based on very little information. We actually administered in some of our companies a comfort with ambiguity test where we try to get you to give us answers when I've given you insufficient information. Anybody can give you answers given sufficient information. But the guys who believe, we believe we do better are the guys who have a leap of logic, intuition, whatever you say, that gut feel, that helps you to arrive at answers given insufficient information. Once upon a time, prize people who said, do this A, B, C, D, E, and they'll better get it. But now you have to say this, get this result, and that person has to figure out what those steps A, B, C, D, E are. Right? So there are a few more things that maybe I'm just taking too much time.
Keep going.
It's a very interesting insight, you know, where you're saying the companies are taking 80% market share. What have you looked at? Are these companies creating a niche for themselves, or is it, are they disrupting the existing market? What? So what I'm seeing in each of these cases, right, is to take 80% of the market,
all of them usually
better created a different market rather than. So everybody was buying bus tickets.
Yeah.
But somebody went and figured out a way to sell online 20 lakh bus tickets a month online.
Yeah.
Right? And again, it was not high elite, but the average Bombay to Pune or Chennai bus tickets, Chennai Hyderabad bus tickets, bought by an average middle class person for 550 to 600 rupees. And everything is about figuring out how to hack it. So for example, we worked really, really hard because we knew we were making only 550 rupees top line a ticket. We were getting 10%, so we were making 55 rupees a ticket. So our cost of acquisition was 11 rupees. So it was a huge 7 years to bring it down. While the typical cost of acquisition in travel, as many of you may know, is 200 to 500 rupees. On e-commerce, it's 800 to 1200 rupees. Again, a friend of mine, and he's not my industry company, he's doing a fantastic job. Book my show. The cost of acquisition for movie ticket is 9 rupees, including everything. The entire cost is 9 rupees. And he's able to make it back because today he's charging
What about some of the failures? I mean, successful ones.
So again, I think where many of this has also come from understanding failures. Right? So, this was an e-com company. We got into it. And we said we're going to do something very, very clear and niche, which is really becoming a men's kind of accessories company. This guy got in and the entrepreneur said, "Nine, I want to go for a much bigger market. I want to take on the entire apparel market, clothing market." He said, "Nine, yeah, you're not." He said, "No, I'm going to take off and do it." And we died. We lost 10 plus crores in that.
Which level?
That's not my I lost a lot of money. So, one big learning there. Another of our companies, also a fashion brand, got into this saying, you know what, we're going to be this slightly cutting edge, slightly premium fashion brand. And because there was sudden dream saying, yeah, let's go sell on the Flipkart platform, let's go sell on the Amazon platform. They went to the Flipkart platform. Flipkart, sure enough, took a 1,000 rupees garment, MRP, bought it for a million, and sold it at 600. Right? So consumers would come to our site and see the product at 1,000, go to Flipkart and see it at 600, and we lost all the sales. Right? It killed the company virtually. So with every other company I sit down, has to be very, very clear before you get on the platform what you do. Right? Because those guys have a lot of money, they're simply discounting to them. You know, they're not there to build a brand there. And I keep joking that the difference between Amazon and Flipkart is that Amazon is in the business of selling products and Flipkart is in the business of selling shares. So
everyone says who's going to be number one and everyone is investing in that, Flipkart, Snappy or ShopKeys or whatever it is. Is it the race for 80% market share worthwhile for the e-commerce?
So here's the thing, I mean, finally in the end, I believe you cannot win, build a brand on this country. Right? You have to build a brand on something core which is new. And then my own belief is that that race is going to be won by Amazon and Walmart. Simply because the other guys are just simply number one. I look at the facts numbers, 10,000 crores in income, 30,000 crores in loss, 20,000 crores in loss, 10,000 crores in loss per year, and losing 1,000 crores a month. Okay. So I keep getting more and more invested. So finally in the end, you know that it's a coping company. I mean, the investor just kind of put a coping, the next investor is an Indian investor. Yeah. My friends were investors out there, all got all the smart money is already out, but they made them need it all.
So you showed about examples where people bring the right.
One of our companies again, built a really sharp product that grew violently huge, violently 300,000 fans and people and so on and so forth. But the four guys, again, you know, we got into this entire mindset of being able to see a team, and they also came with a team, but they had created a team like 3 months before they came to us. And they started fighting on themselves and we lost that company. Because promoters couldn't stand each other. Right? I have since rethought this entire notion of team. So it's a very American notion. I want to see a great team together. Like, look at you. If I look at any great Indian company, one guy and one woman founded it. Even if I look at any great American company, one guy founded it. Eventually, team comes together. I mean, so who was Branson's partner? I don't know. Who was Premji's partner? Who was Ambani's partner? I mean, all these guys, one guy built a company. So after that, it's good. And most of our most successful companies have been built by, I mean, it was fun. A couple of guys around who, you know, who joined in, Mohit and his gang. So we back.
Also, political party.
Political party. One person is fine. So, you know, I have revised my own entire thinking on this team thing. It's very American. Yeah? You know, I briefly got into that mode. After that, I fucked up. Go back and said, no, you need one demented, passionate person. That's what you want. And that person should have the charisma, he or she. You can pull a team around them for willing to work at less than market cost. That's really the key one. And then you can change.
So Mahesh, I had a question about talking about, you know, monopolies and companies. No, I'm understanding. So companies having 60-80% market shares, in the enterprise space at least, Salesforce might be the leader, but they probably just have 20% market share.
In that particular CRM space, they are
20-25% majority of the CRM market is by smaller players. So 40-50% of CRM market.
So you see the same thing. For example, if you look at Slack, direct messaging, it has virtually 80% market with zero spend. So $2 million of revenues.
The point I'm coming to is, you know, if there's a certain product and they've done wonderful engineering, the product's really good. The product really has had this word of mouth, and a similar product comes up, right? Now, what is the moat that prevents the competitor from taking over the market share? Now, is this a moat that the original innovator has created? For example, in Tracto's case, right, they have a pretty solid moat. Even if a competitor wants to sell a SaaS to a doctor, it's not going to work, right? Because they have this whole consumer business as well. You're talking about the moat created in Red Bus's case, where even if the bus operator had to move on, they would have to do a lot of work. In Red Bus's case, for example, so the question would be, if they did not have the moat, they just had the brand, do you think the competitors would not have been able to win?
So what is a moat? The brand is a moat, right? So let me answer that question in a few ways. So little things, for example, why did Slack win against other messaging software? Most of them have the same functions, and it comes down to the fact that they were a little bit cooler. They use a few cooler colors, that's all, because of better UI. That little better UI was enough to create a network effect where everybody said, I want to be on Slack because he's on Slack. At which point you become an unstoppable force. Right? They figured out what the little thing was. There has to be some differentiation. Everybody, there are different insights in every case. In Red Bus's case, I think, when we had a long discussion, it was pre-crack testing. So I had done a huge amount of stuff, you know, to one of my companies. We'd done work in Yalta and we might have been able to figure out we had a conversion rate for travel in India. It's a really good 3%. And we started with 0.5%. Somewhere between 0.5% and 3%. Today it's about 4%. 1 out of 25 people buy. And I remember having this discussion with Fahim. And he said, Mahesh, I don't understand that. If 100 people come to a bus ticketing website, why would only 3 buy? I didn't have an answer. So he did something really interesting. For 7 years, and once a week, every week for 7 years, he would do A-B test on some part of the site and figure out which produced a greater conversion rate. Even if it was a 0.1 conversion rate, 0.1% conversion rate increase, next week the site would move to that and would test something else. So over a 7 year period, 350 site updates. You know what conversion rate they ended up? 28%. What that meant was to get the same number of actual ticket sales as midpoint, we needed 1/7 the number of visitors. What it also meant was people thought of Redbus as a utility, not as a should I buy whatever, but I must buy it. It's like IRC is something I can then use.
Yeah, same with Google My Show, for example.
Yeah, Google My Show.
That's
extraordinary conversion rate, right? So little things. So, and these moats can change over time.
So, but that's a, I mean, it's not a physical mode that a competitor cannot copy. So when we have
more modes a competitor cannot copy, these modes are temporary.
But networks, for example, you know, network effects.
Network effects, you know, if you look at it, everybody was on MySpace.
Yeah.
Everybody was on Outlook.
Right.
Everybody was on Hi-Fi. And all of those died. And they all have great network effects. Nothing I'm suggesting to you is a perpetual mode.
Yeah.
Nothing. And very often, in fact, the really cool thing I found, again, one of the rules of marketing I was brought up with was you don't need to do a line extension, you need an answer, you can't go. You know, if you're doing ketchups, then you can do sauces and then you can do spices. But look at pretty Google yet, search, email, maps, mobile operating systems, self-driving cars, satellite on the moon.
Accents.
There's no line extension logic.
And why do you think Google Plus failed?
Because I think they had nothing differentiated against you that allowed enough people to move in against Facebook, which had already had in some markets. So Google is at the 8%, 8.5%, and Facebook is at the 85% failure. They didn't have that. So while they were able to disrupt Hotmail or an email, they were not able to disrupt Facebook because they came with one feature, circles, and Facebook replicated that in 3 days. And they came back to that.
Because when I moved from Orkut to Facebook, I actually missed some of Orkut's functionality.
Yeah. The fact that you could anonymously stalk chicks. I'm sure it's
it's even the entire Scrapbook functionality there, whatever they had. Product did not seem, you know, really. So even in Zara's case, I think I shop from Zara. I don't go there because the brand name is really cool or my friends are buying it. I go there because nothing else fits for whatever reason. They the products they have are good. So that's what the product they have.
Actually, I found the opposite experience. Zara's fit is more for Europeans. It doesn't fit us Indians.
I know. It won't fit my brother who's a bit,
So you're European. No, I don't know if that's a sustainable thing. Because finally, we use the many people at the same time. Right. These are things that you should justify. But if you look at what Facebook did, you're not be right. They basically said, we're not going to open it to the world. We're going to make sure that territory, which is a college, we're going to go to college. Alexander the Great. He conquered the world, but he didn't send his army out to fight Darius at the same time. He said, I'm in this city. I'm going to take that city. I'm going to take that province. I'm going to take this country. Then I'm going to take the next city, next province, next province, next country. And that's how it's around the world. I think it's pretty much the same. You do one thing really well at a time. So the reason, so what they did was, eventually you moved to Facebook, because a girl went to Facebook. Right? And they went to Facebook because it ensured real names were used. The problem with Orkut that girls had was a bunch of guys with anonymous names could harass you. And hence, Orkut was always 80% male, 20% male. Facebook is not. And eventually when the girls went there, you had to go there too. You look sort of suspect.
Maxim, what? Don't tell me you missed the boat.
No, I
haven't. Damn, I shouldn't have done that.
Did
I answer your question?
For the first time in the answer, the question has been answered in many other times.
Stuff that made news.
So a lot of more effective, because again, the most powerful tool here is the ability to go from mouth to mouth. So if you're unable to do that, so let me put it this way. And I say this, so your marketing IQ is going to be inversely proportional to your marketing budget. If you're dumb, you'll have to spend a lot of money. If you're smart, you can get away by spending much less money. Either by creating news, which doesn't need a lot of media money, right? Or creating a product which doesn't need to, which creates its own news. So more and more of advertising, the winners will advertise less, the losers will advertise more.
So I'm trying to understand something. So you're really saying is that when you're engineering a product or a service, think of the marketing strategy, the time of building it versus at the time of being. That's what you're
trying to do. The most important time to look at marketing is when you're designing a product.
Not when you're building.
Because after there's very little effort.
I think that's kind of what you're trying to drive.
Yeah, because more and more increasing in the last 5 years. But let's see, Red Bull is still Red Bull. What was engineered in the product? They changed the distribution system, they changed the position. Zara is still Zara. I've deliberately put in offline and online cases here because it's not that everything is mobile at the full by. So Zara was marketed and distributed in a way that allowed it to kill Coke, Pepsi's energy drinks and chips. The consumer insight was different. It was powerful and more. To the point, like even with Red Bull, like a couple of years ago, they sent a guy to space, and he jumped up, Felix Baumgart, and the world, 50 television channels from around the world paid them for right to cover that. Here, you have to pay a TV channel to cover it, and then TV channels are paying them to cover it. Plus, they got co-sponsors like Zenith Watches and others, said, okay, want to be part of this. So they actually spent $15 million and about $600 million for advertising over one strike. So it is about outsmarting and not about outspending. So I really, when somebody says, you know, I need to get a lot of money because he raised so much money and I need to beat him, I need to raise more money than him. I know both companies are going to lose. So all the guys in the current trading scenario, I think a year or two from now, you'll see them all with their backs to the wall. Right? Advertising budgets absolutely are the inverse of guaranteeing you success. Sorry.
My question, you said word of mouth is very important. But you know, you need a critical mass to reach that stage. Either some task that you need to advance or still you have a disagreement.
See, you know, I mean, it all comes down to saying, you need one guy to try. So first of all, you talk to introduce it yourself. Let one person figure out if two, three people try. And initially, if you want to seed it for 1,000 people, you want to get 1,000 downloads, you want to give it 1,000 copies, you say, that's easy. That doesn't cost money. But if you're doing it beyond 10,000 to 100,000, then there's a problem. That means there's a problem in the product, it's not taken out. Go back to the drawing board, re-engineer the product, don't waste money on advertising. Keep going out testing it, saying, is it catching fire or not catching fire? Is it not catching fire, take it back. And say, okay, what's going to make it catch fire? What's my consumer insight? What do I understand about the user? What does she think? What does she feel? Why is she not using this? How can I find this? You have a question.
Two things. One is very specific of an example that you quoted. That was about Zara. So, it was that, you know, they would change the inventory with the days. This was a very specific question. There
will
be a lot of unsold inventory. So
here's what I got. That's really interesting. I figured it out now. So I went to Hong Kong last year, and I read the example. So I went to buy a leather jacket. I went to store a leather jacket. It wasn't in my size. Didn't have it. I said, "Okay, koi baat nahi. Hong Kong mein aur do dukaan hai. Main jaunga." So I went to another Zara store 3 kilometers away. It didn't have either product jacket. And what was in this store was not in that store. What was in that store was not in this store. So all it was in moving around store.
Sure.
So every day is here. I guess they're in Bangalore. Yeah, so they moved around.
Yes. There's a second question. Most of the examples that you've taken are products. And I'm not part of the question that I'm asking. This is on behalf of there's a lot of companies in Chennai, for example, which are service-based companies and largely to say a mobile application development also. So how do they create
from a user's point of view, product and service is the same thing. I call it an offering. Technically, is a Salesforce a product? Is it a service? Who knows? Right. Where are we overall? Is it a product? Is it a service? Who knows? It's an offering.
Yeah.
Right. But why has, for example, White Flower Hall become, you know, created an enormous name, even though it has no ad budget? Because it's something that service they offer
that package that often we offer that really shines me.
You know, the same thing is true of services. Why is it that you absolutely love the cut service? You know, you go online and you figure out that people, a bunch of people hate Flipkart service and a bunch of people love Amazon service. Why is that? Because finally, in the end, you buy the same kind of product from both places.
Yeah.
The offering is the same. Both sell the same amount of stuff, same kinds of stuff, at roughly the same prices. But what is your focus on? So in that case, it's only service, because the only differentiator is service, not price.
Because most of the people are competing on the same basis. Why I'm asking this question? Because this is relevant to most of the
countries. You're absolutely right.
In the same space.
How has Cognizant gone and really ramped up in the last 5 years? And John, you absolutely talk against Infibius. They have differentiated their offering. They've gone into far more product focused service. As in, you know, we take the entire product and design it, and we show you that we have this.
No,
they're really, really smart guys.
They have invested ahead of time in new technologies.
They
did something
There is a differentiator that has word of mouth, where all the CIOs and CTOs in the US, let's say, what was Cognizant? When they meet and talk, Cognizant did this one. Because, again, they're a client, man, I understand what they do. You figure out that what they give the client is a deeper insight into his business than what he gives us. Right? So the client is looking at him for a good purpose. They have zero advantage. So my point is, it's not, you talk about brands, but I'm trying to turn this around because some people focus saying brands are not created by advertising anymore. Brands are created with a differentiated experience, a differentiated offer. That is relevant and word of mouth.
So this is coming to quote as the differentiation of price reductions. Price reduction is no longer a choice.
Price is no longer a thing. You know, if I look at it, I don't even know what is a premium brand or what is a discount brand anymore. When Microsoft came out in Netscape, Netscape was charging for its browser and service software. Microsoft gave IE free and killed Netscape. It did all the office, which was Microsoft's cash cow. So Google gave me Google Office free to kill Office. But Google charges for AdWords. So the same company is doing free somewhere and highly paid somewhere else. So what is the discount? Is it a cheap company? Is it a discount company? I don't know. Depending on when I want to go from Chandigarh to Delhi. If I want to go tomorrow, every airline is expensive. If I want to go next week, every airline is cheap. What's the premium? What's the discount? I don't. Those things, more than the ability to say premium discount, I think what makes a difference is your ability to change your dime, to choose to be premium one day and discount next year, that makes a difference. Yeah, your ability to just move on a bit.
Sure.
No questions. No questions. And this is really one, you know, Madonna's another.
If I see
that,
wait, what is the key factor that you look at for willing to make decisions that you want agility and willingness to make first of all?
So a lot of it is really interviewing the founder and figuring out, you know, how that person is used to working. Most entrepreneurs by nature are jugaadus. I look for that jugaadu person. Right? You know, very structured, and you want everything to be set in place. It's going to be really difficult. Because somebody out there who thinks differently, who thinks younger, thinks faster, is going to outrun your opinion. So I look for that jugaadu. Right? But that's only one of the things. I mean, there are 3, 4, 5 things I look before I plan out to start. First thing is, I'm saying this from Michigan. Can this start to make a dent in business? Can this make a real difference? Actually, the zeroth thing is, can I sell this? Can I exit this stuff? And that is a big discussion, right? Because how do I exit? I can only exit if either by taking the profit or by selling it to somebody else. I can only take the profit. If you, at the end of my investment, if you get 50 plus crores in revenues, and I'm going to get double digit percentage rates out of that. If you can't get that revenue, I know you can't move on. So my next choice is, can you be sold? For you to be sold, you have to be a dominant market leader. Can you become the dominant market? If not, you can be a good business, great business, but I can't do this because I can't get my money out. That's the first thing, can I exit? The second thing is, okay, given that, okay, there's some possibility of exit, can you make a really big difference? Can you take a dominance or whatever? The third thing is,
can you build a team around you? You have the charisma to pull off a bunch, get a bunch of people to work for you at the market prices. And not ever come to me and say, you can take market services. Because nobody in the startup has market services. And you're not in a successful startup has market services. The fourth thing is it something that I can help with? For example, if you come to me with something in chemical processing, I know nothing about it, so I can't do it. I'll probably send it to somebody else. But there's some stuff, and I understand consumer a little bit, I understand brand a little bit, I understand tech a little bit. So those things I can help open doors. Because I believe in the early stage, you don't need money as much as you need some places, time and other stuff. The fifth thing is, you don't go and get along with people. As in, there will be times when I shout at you. There will be times when you just talk at me. You will have great times, you will have great times. You still have a beer and chat and still give. You see me as a guy on the other side, but you see me as a guy on the other side. You still just make a call. You have to let me make mistakes. So we still make mistakes. So we learn them. That's every time you make a mistake, we try to learn and go back and say, I'm going to.
See, let's say you're saying that as a founder, you need to really focus on shorter goals where you get to go phase and up the next one. But as an investor, you know, that was tired, you want to have so many ways. How do you manage your time? How do you manage your energy?
So it's been different at different points in my life, right? So one of the things I really believe in a lot is delivery. And I find people give them the work before they're ready. Just come in and just do a. I mean, I can either be a control freak investor, but then that means I have to run the company myself. I don't have the time to do it. Or I can be generally a hands-off investor who feels comfortable enough with you to be able to call you at any odd moment as a
parent.
That's the point. So from my point of view, I have to be, so it's not just diversified. For example, all of my bets are in consumer technology. So I don't have, you know, some future B2B company, B2B company, chemical B2B. Because we understood something, and we don't have, I have never had a sector focus. In fact, my belief is that the biggest companies happen in what's called not yet sectors. The Red Bus side was not a sector, I was not a sector. So all the big hits have come from not yet sectors. So I look for things that are not sectors to get into. And I don't have a problem unless you're in adjacent businesses. So we have two or three businesses that sell to schools. So I don't have a top-down thing saying I will do so much in education, so much in healthcare, so much in this, so much in that. I don't know how to do that. It's like whatever businesses come my way, you can go outside. And how the math works out is that for every 10 companies, you know, in Silicon Valley, 8 will, you know, 5 will fail, 2 will give you super high returns, 2 or 3 will give you returns. In our case, 2 will fail. 2 or 3 will be hard to exit in a period of time, so they're not going to check or check for them. 1 to give you 10x. And then 2-3 will give you 1-5x. 1-3x. And all of this averages to like a fund between 3x or 8x or 10x.
Is that because of your station criteria is
okay? I think it's going to be your luck at most.
How do you plan how much to give?
So, again, this is something that your beliefs change over a period of time. But broadly, my belief used to be that, okay, you know, I used to ask for a detailed cash flow chart. This is just one spreadsheet, that, you know, on a month-wise spreadsheet saying, give me your costs in the month that you incur the costs, and give me your revenues in the month that you collect your revenues. And give me the revenues minus cost number at the bottom. So, you know, people make a loss. So if I do that cumulatively, what happens is, it's a curve that goes like this, and comes to zero at that point. That sum to me is your sum of deficit financing. So I need to give you that much money to break. Plus, let me know that 1 or 2 quarters of safety. Right? So that's my funding amount. Plus, then the valuation. How does it get decided? I want X percent of your company, I'm going to give you the search number. That determines the valuation. There's no fancy. That's it. I will give you 6 crores because you need 6 crores. And I need 30% of your company. So, there are 2 of your companies that will get 80 crores, 20 crores, whatever it is. 20 crores. That's it.
That's,
we take between 26% and 40%. Yeah, my
Yes.
Yes.
Let me go ahead.
My question is, why there is no another Book My Show? Like, why there is one Book My Show? Why someone other
there? There are others who tried. These guys got the dominant share. That's it. They ended up with 90% share.
So So how they have taken, like, why other could not do it, like,
the nature of businesses is increasingly that tends to, you know, why is there not another one? It's why is it all, it's a, my point about, the meta point about my talk today is that we now have the dominance of governance. It's not about 19% market share versus 20% market share anymore. If you do it right, you can win the market. All of it. Of course, then you'll be faced with all the other concerns like competition commission and antitrust that Google is facing. Okay, that's a good problem. You're too dominant. But my entire nature of my talk is to really say exactly your point that if you do it right, there are many other guys who were selling tickets, who tried to sell tickets, but they hadn't made it as pleasurable as Bookmy should have. And there was no mode for Bookmy show. Everybody had the same access to it. They simply used UI and lower costs and drove that time and again and time and again and time again.
All the operations are actually different than
the except, you know, we didn't do PVR, big guys were on PVR, they didn't do the area. They didn't do small cables.
Mitra is planning to, you know, go only to mobile apps. What's your
I think it's true. There's one thing I learned. I remember I was designing it. I was doing Amazon's website design 20 years ago. And there was a big discussion then on whether we should use tables or not. Because IE 3.0 does not, and 3.0 is supporting tables. And my designers love tables, because tables are great. And favorite tables or something. And what we figured was if we did tables of fields, then it would not work on the Lynx browser, which was a text-only browser. At that point, in 1996, 0.1% of Amazon's traffic was coming on the Lynx browser. Those are American servicemen who were stationed in Kosovo, who were buying stuff through their text-only browsers because that was the internet access there. So we went to Bezos with this. And he threw us up saying, why would I not want that 0.1% of
customers? And then the
app
downloads, they have, you know, automatic
versions
for
I am not saying go to the Mitra every
day. Yeah.
Right? And what about the new generation? I mean, every year, 25 million people come out of school in India and start using apps. How will they know whether to download an app or not? Right? And after some point, I don't get it.
So, I have got two questions.
Sure.
First is, you know, we were talking on Mitra.
Right. Yeah.
So, what's
your name?
I'm Maxil.
Right.
So, one is so one is that Mitra is going app only. You're into the, you know, the consumer space. 10 years from now, you know, what do you think the future of you know, consumer in mobile would be? Because I did 15 years ago, everything on PC was an app. You know, Microsoft Office. Everything was an app. Your CRMs were an app. You know, you had a couple of things. Then everything shifted over to web. Do you think the same would happen on mobile?
I don't know what the future will bring. But if I was roughly going by any judge of how people use media, is that media never dies. We're still using media. We're still using television. We're still using newspapers. We're still using magazines. We're still using billboards. We're still using computers. We're still using mobile phones. Nothing is dead. Maybe you don't use telex machines. We don't use fax machines. I don't think the PC in 10 years is going to go the way of the current machine. It's going to be there, it's going to be used. It is more convenient for some people, it is more convenient for some larger screen. That's what the attack is doing. There will be, I cannot imagine a world where people don't use a browser. Because as more and more information gets circulated, if you research, you will have to compare, you will need reviews. And imagine if you don't show up on a browser. Like I, you know, just yes, today somebody I was checking a tweet right now, was coming up with and somebody said, this is ridiculous, I'm on the browser, Mitra says this product is only available in the app book and the iPhone. I don't understand it at all. Maybe these guys are super geniuses, they get something. I think it's stupid.
I
think it's just a convoluted and complicated Pinterest. That's a mobile only app. Pinterest is about doing this stuff on that mobile.
Pinterest actually generated that from the start.
It's from the start, right? But I don't know what you're going to win by doing that.
So I have a second question. You said figuring out the product and you know, the what your company probably is trying to do is probably far more important than investing in marketing,
Say
that product market fit.
Absolutely. This is what I'm talking about. You have a, so we have an example of HubSpot, who's a lot of whose success could be attributed to their absolutely fantastic inbound marketing strategy. Do you have any examples where the product was amazing, but the founders of the company failed to execute properly on sales and marketing, and even the other way around, where the product was bad, but the founders executed perfectly in marketing and whatever growth hacking you might term it, or you know, blog and blah blah blah.
So I think there are many examples of both. So in the digital world, I remember Google Wave. Mm-hmm. It was an incredible product, except we didn't know how to position marketing. Nobody knew what they could do with it. Mm-hmm. It just simply didn't make it. Right. Similarly, the examples of pretty, like I said, WhatsApp, there's nothing technically great about the product versus WeChat. It's quite the opposite. WeChat is 10 years ahead of WhatsApp. WhatsApp is 8 times ahead. Or 5 times ahead.
User interface is not very good, WeChat.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Yeah. So it's essentially, it's not about writing more lines, it's just getting that fit of the product to market. WhatsApp understands the market and fits it better than WeChat. Gmail understood the meta and market and fit it better than Hotmail. And here in 3 months, 6 months.
I just asked the question, I just reading this book by Ben Horowitz, and he takes time, you know, running loud cloud through the bubble burst and everything. Even if you, so,
but it does, it doesn't work. LoudCloud was just getting an exit selling to every forward market builder. He was talking about survival.
A lot of their success could be attributed to their hiring the right people in sales and in marketing.
But even success is a relative term. Their success was survival, not dominance. Mm-hmm. It was survival to sell the company and get out.
But with surviving at a time when everybody else was dying, so
that's okay. I mean, that's, I understand, but that's not really a dominant share of the market. But what they had to do is they had to completely regenerate the product. No, I agree that it's both and not. But the lessons are different. Yeah.
Flipkart, for example, what it is now is like, if I had access to Flipkart, they were Brazilian.
I don't know, man. I mean, there are some belief that they can't compete on price, they can't compete on other issues. So they're trying to say, come use me on the app. Because the app is more opaque. When you use an app, you can't do side-by-side product comparisons.
There's a lot of stuff
you can't do junkie.com on an app. Between app prices. You can't go in, you know, you can't review.
But then again, they're losing customers,
I
mean, they don't care.
Okay.
So, concept, I guess, as an investor, you always want to look for an exit from an investor perspective.
Huh.
So, when companies don't exit, do they always die, or do they actually have a better chance of not exiting at all? So, I mean, organic.
So, there's a lot of, I spent a lot of time thinking about this, and I, in fact, was talking to Murthy on the way up. So, one of the problems that we developed in India is we have copied the American venture model,
right,
which is a 10-year or 8+2-year fund, or 9+2-year fund model. So, here's what happens, and I know I've run 3 of these funds myself, right? So, you do a 10-year fund. So, you, let's say I start putting in a couple of companies. It's going to take me 3-4 years to find the companies to invest in. After that, I have 5-6 years. I'm not going to wait to year 10, so I want to exit by year 9. So on an average, I have 6.5 years in a company. Now, I have to, if I'm doing early stage startups, I can't do anything in 6.5 years in India. If you look at the companies that have reached any kind of reasonable exit in the technology space, not going to 10.5 years to exit. And then build stock price 4x over the next 4 years. Make money took 11 years to exit. Just that took 17 years to exit. And these are the youngest companies that have exited. Most companies on the BSE have taken 20, 25 years to exit. And here we try to find an exit in 6.5 years. So what happens is that all this unnatural behavior happens. Somebody says, I have to exit in 6.5 years. Cram it, buy front page of advertising, do some shit advertising, get more top line, forget about bottom line. Sell the product, discount it, doesn't matter. The other day I saw an ad from ShopCruise that said 120% off. Buying a product for 100 rupees, they're going to give you 20 rupees. And 100 rupees.
No, they're right. Maximum 2,000 rupees.
So, my point is essentially, you're actually in a race to die.
Mahesh, why? It's not about answering my question there.
Sorry?
Why is the exit difference there? It takes longer to exit in India.
It just, it, first of all, it takes longer to exit anywhere. Even Google took 7 years to exit, Facebook took 9 years to exit.
Right? It takes longer to visit anywhere. We have an artificially short period, especially here. So first of all, it takes time for you to become a critical mass. In the US, you have so many users, you can have 1 million. Assume that 1 million users is a critical mass. 2-3 million users in a game in the US. Try getting to 1 million in 2 months and then very difficult. It'll take 8 months, 10 months, it'll be very good. It just takes long. It gets you longer to get your phone connection, your internet connection, to get your employees hired. To get anything working, it takes longer. So hence, the entire idea of a 10-year fund. Actually, we made a huge amount of money on RedBus. But we could have made 10 times as much if we had waited for more years. We did really well on Carbon. We sold it at a price of X. Today, 5 years later, it's being funded at 11X. We invested on 11X, even though we made some X. It's because we fund structures in India not designed to support long-term. Which is another problem for me. All the guys I mentioned, my heroes are the Bransons and the Musks and the Jobs and the Gates of the world. They all took 20, 30 years to build their businesses. Here, we want you in and out in 5 years. We never want you to become big. We want you to be a small pop entrepreneur. We never let you become a big bang entrepreneur. Our entire system is designed to never create a great entrepreneur.
So
it's a huge problem. It's my problem. Right. So my next one I'm trying to design is a way that hopefully somewhere
sort of. So
essentially there are a couple of things. My basic problem with fund, even though from what my at least with me for the vintage of a fund, maybe the best performing funds in India in the last 10 years. Both my funds. But still the problem has been that I know in each case I've left lots of money on the table, simply because we had to exit at the 8-year mark or the 10-year mark. So I kind of figured that for a company in India, especially if you do early stage, you won't really get the benefit of the biggest bank for the buck. You have to own it between 15 and 20 years. So the first thing I'm trying to do is create a 20-year plus fund, or perpetual capital fund, which is permanent. Then there are some other wrinkles in that, I don't need to talk about it, of how my investors can exit the fund and stuff. There's some crazy thinking that I've got. I'm seeing if I can just structure it. It's not been structured. No animal like that exists in the world. So that's what I like. A simple way of putting it is like Berkshire Hathaway for India startups. Like a holding company that holds companies for a long period. My simple thing is that if RedBus is a great company, why should I sell it? I should own it forever. That's what I want to structure, where I own a company forever.
Because it's funny, right? When you talk in IT, you talk about retaining is better than, retaining is cheaper than recruiting.
Yeah.
So if you have built a company from
but
A to B,
VC funds are structured in such a crazy way.
Money doesn't have memory. People have. So what I'm saying is funds which help create a company have memory more valuable than the money itself.
Absolutely. But the problem is structure, right? My investors are used to the US structure, so everybody in India has copied the US structure. It's going to take me a while to find the investors who believe in the different structure. It's a different if I say that, you're an investor, say I'm going to do a 20-year plus fund, because it'll give you better returns, and say, yeah, great, but shit, 20 years? Right? So I have a way of overcoming that. You're investor.
No, I was just going to contribute an observation on those comments about the app-only environment. I think it's also driven by the new
industry companies. It was a little crazy where we took about 65 people, put them on. We said we were doing offset and work. Everybody came and they stayed for a couple of days. And one day we said we were going to do an exercise study. We put them into buses and took them to the Goa Karnataka border, about 68 kilometers away from the hotel. And at 6 p.m., we took them onto the bus. We said, give me your cell phones, give me your wallets, give me anything of value, give it all to us, we'll keep it safe. We gave everybody 1 rupee and 1 bottle of water. We said, make your way back. Which is 68 kilometers away, and we drop them at 7 p.m. And they had to follow a particular path and go past a particular number of 3 different waypoints. And a lot of it was through forest. And half of them were women.
Half of women?
Yeah. So, of course, we had a bunch of HR trainers who always get view of them, they're not looking at them. But the amazing thing is the first team reached at 3 in the morning, the last team reached at 7 in the morning. And everybody, it was the most transformational experience of their life. Because they have to hack it. They have to stop, beg rides, milk cows, deliver newspapers, deliver milk to whatever, ride on trucks, because they had to do what they had to do.
So it can be brought in, and it's hugely empowering to somebody. See, I think it also starts with our parenting. We never allow our kids to have a life where they make their own decisions.
Exactly.
We direct every part of it, and everything in our school system is, again, except maybe the IB or some system, is about you have to learn these things exactly that way, you're not going to pass, you're not going to take it to IIT, whatever it is. Right? So our individuality and, okay, I just come here, our initiativeness has been squeezed out of us. But that's the one thing, the reason why I think the US does such a great job, I think that's because you have to be far more jobbed out of there to survive. So it's, I don't know if it's something that we train in. It's certainly something that we admire, respected, lauded, and more people should be encouraged to really think that way. Because you really need those people. You can't just have, you know, one team saying, this is the Jugaad team in the office and this is a old world team. These guys, I mean, you know, the inmates have to be given the assignment, they have to run the assignment.
Well, that's the way the system works.
I mean, it depends on the system.
If you present yourself in a different way, then you have to fight with that.
But that's okay, it's never easy. Now, who said it's easy? The thing is, entrepreneurship is a calling, it's not a career. It's your life, you have lived a life that way that we live it. And if it is your calling, you will do what you have to do, you will do what you need to do. It's a calling.
I want to make one point, one observation, which I, especially for the education sector, see, a lot of people are from the lower economic startup, right? So what I have found is a lot of people cannot afford. So, as in meditation, I see there is a lot of scope, especially for the people who cannot afford the...
That's okay, one day they will afford the laptop, huh? It's not like everybody's going to always share the success
when people are responsible. But they can't, if you buy a smartphone or something like that, you would probably have a hang of it and you would never try to, you know, buy a laptop.
No, it's not true. I'll give you the case
office
of
my office.
Probably you would buy a tab.
Office with a tab. Sir, desktop will
get up. It's not, I haven't said that. The first surprise came Monday, you know, I'm saying that I live alone, and I said, she may have been calling me for breakfast, I mean, whatever. My phone goes ping, and I see a WhatsApp message. What the papa are you going to come here? Right? So she kind of figured out, now she doesn't know English. Whatever, she figured out. But she's now been with me for 3 years, right? I gave her, I had a spec room, client, you know, she also runs a media agency and stuff. So she wanted to run her own business. So she's got a database of maids, other maids that she's facing. She can't be on the phone. How do you sort, you know, an access database on the phone?
No, I'm not going to get an app.
No, I'm saying it's not easy for her. So for her, she needs that screen size. She uses it. So I don't say, and she, now I see a more than that. So she uses this laptop for her work. But she does, she sets some stuff on Facebook with them. She's very enterprising.
My question was, everybody who operate over this time, but still there's a lot of chunk in the base.
See,
always the base.
See, your logic is to me the equivalent of saying, why would people listen to the radio when you can see audio and video on the television?
Yeah.
Of course, but then in most cases.
The
affordability of the radio is much more than that of the TV. So I don't believe the world will go to a world where there's 100% mobile, 0% laptop. We are always going to be in a hybrid world.
My question is more from an investor's point of view.
we have kind of this change in Chandigarh for the industry and startup. There's a lot of talk on the multiple node versus taking an equity. What's your take on it?
For angel investing, not like.
So, I need a only 15% response in my credit business. But if you have a majority share, there's nothing like saying, okay, I'm going to take this here. Why only I'm going to go to the wife or converse it from the market back? It depends on your market power to price it the way you want to price it.
No, is it to a disadvantage? But that is what I have been made to believe that to a disadvantage that if you ask for an equity in the very beginning, and the next day investor would be kind of using that wrong word, pissed off that you have already given a lot.
I'm an next stage investor. Correct? If some angel has already taken 80% of company, I say, yeah, then okay. I don't want to touch it because
What exactly would you tax that doesn't exceed that?
So if it's 10%, 15%, I don't know. I don't have a problem. That's perfectly good.
What is happening actually is people end up with 30-35%.
So, but the problem is exactly what you say. I've seen angels.
They screw you over.
Who have taken 80% of a company for 5 lakhs.
That's 15% is a case thing. No? They would be ready to patch it.
It's actually subject to how you value it also.
Exactly.
And that's the thing is
very relative actually.
See, my point is, here's the overworking, right? I need a trust of company. I know there's other investors who want about a third of the company and I want to take on to have a third of it. Roughly, that's the way to value. And I'll be backing my seat. So I may come down from 30 to 25. I've been diluted in subsequent rounds. But roughly, I still want, you know, the early stage guys to have a third growth, guys to have a third or profit world, and entrepreneurs to have a third, motor model, I want to have. But it's something 10-15% because it's 1 crore, is it 10-15% because you put a huge amount of hard work into the other company? I don't even know what it is, right? So I have a judge, angel versus the angel versus the angel.
It's all subjective actually.
Because it's not just a 15%.
But then again, instead of smart friends or era, second year in industry together. So I disagree with them that it cannot be only convertible mode. At time we should ask for equity. Even if it is 1%, 2%, 3%,
5%. I don't have a problem with that.
Is it a bad case?
So here is the thing about a convertible loan. What if you never get an extra? See, one thing I learned. I started investing in 99. The whole world crashed. Dot-com crash happened in 2001.
2000.
Then I started my fund in 2006. In 2008, the world fell apart. V9. My second fund was in 2010, in 2012 Greece happened. So I'm reasonably sure that 2 years after I started fund, the world will fall apart. Enough anecdotal evidence that I am causing some severe disruption to the world.
Right? Is it coming the next fund?
So my next fund is going to be in like early 2016.
Oh god.
But facetiousness aside, what are you doing in a down market and nobody's touching a company? What is your convertible worth? And what if after all that you still get a down round?
Yes, you can.
So I don't really know what it is. What if there's, I mean that, for example, what is it? Your investment is the only investment of the next 10 years. So what is actually the value of the holding? And somebody buys a company or it goes public. What is the value of the holding if you do convertible? And on what basis is it convertible? I mean, for example, I do convertible bridges with my own company that I want to mess or whatever. I say, hey, you know, I'll give you some money and I'll take a 2% discount per month. And I'll set the max at 30% discount. Whatever, right? That means I put a pressure on him to find the money fast. Rather than a fixed discount, where he's in no hurry to find out the executive. But if I do a discount, say, hey, I'm a daughter.
Then
he is going to get an extra.
But the first case is what there is an extra like that. I don't know, but
that's a good. That's a really good
idea. Yeah.
That's the pressure of him to find an extra.
So the
next one I'm seeing also is
you may not be able to
do that. But you can do it again saying, okay, look, for every year it is X, for every 6 months.
So exactly.
Exactly. That makes sense.
Or you can say, I'll give you 2 years, and after 2 years,
It starts by
true, true, true.
So you can still structure it.
But we have seen a counter case also where an entrepreneur was extremely aggressive. He said, you know what, 6 months, this is it. Then, and he didn't want to do 2 years. He said, for 2 years, if I don't raise the money, I failed as a business. So he actually went counter. He set the bar like this, I will make sure I raise it.
See, that's all good, but my point is, you know, we are going through a period of irrational exuberance right now. Right? We went through a complete despondence to that exuberance, and we will come back. I predict that there will be a complete downturn in the next 6 to 8 months. Especially in the e-com funding and dot-com funding.
It's not.
It's only started. I mean, Flipkart books faster, it has to do a note. It couldn't do it. Everybody's cramping around. You know, all the food startups are going to budget with each other, but yes. Nobody, there's no fresh money.
Only one at the moment.